Good morning. Welcome to worship today. So glad to see everyone out here. What a beautiful day the Lord's given us. Shall we stand?
Present your word, bless our fellowship, and be with us and watch over us. May we glorify you in all that we do and said, and all God's people said,
Amen.
And you may be seated. We'd like the church leader to come on up and meet Mr. Ron.
Come on up, guys. How's everybody doing this morning?
Good.
You like being outside?
Huh?
This is better than being inside, isn't it? I think so. God gave us a beautiful day, didn't he? Mm-hmm. Look all around. Got all kinds of things here. Have birdies. You hear birdies? Hear crickets? Hear ants? Ants don't make any noise, do they? Hear the flies? Buzz, buzz. I don't like flies.
Bees?
Bees, buzz, buzz, buzz. Anything else? We have wildebeests? I don't see any wildebeests around here. All right. Where am I going with all this? Believe it or not, I think I'm going somewhere if I get there. All right. God says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 26, look at the birds in the air. They do not sow or weep or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they are? Now, do you know what that means? That's very simple, okay? Simple for me anyway, right? But what it means is God loves the birds, and the birds don't do anything that we do, okay? Don't you think that you're more special than a bird? Do you? I love birdies, but I think you guys are all better than birdies. I wouldn't trade 100 birdies for one of you. All right? So, if you are more important than the birdies, and God takes care of birdies, then what does that mean God does for you? Yeah, he takes care of you. So why are we all, and I guess us bigger people are probably worse with that than you, but why are we all worried all the time, huh? God's going to take care of us, right? If you believe in Jesus, and I know you do, then God's going to take care of you. That's it. Like Alfred E. Newman would say, what, me worry? Don't worry. God's going to take care of you, all right? No matter how bad things get, how bad things get, that test, and let's be honest, we didn't really study for that test the way God wants us to, did we?
No.
Does that mean he's going to bail us out and give us a good grade? No, that's not the way he works. But he will take care of you and make you learn from that, and in the long run, you'll be a good person. So just don't worry. Okay? All right, let's pray, okay? Dear God, thank you for all these wonderful children here today and the ones that are at home, maybe listening on the internet or maybe took a hooky day today, whichever. You know you still love them. And please let them know how important they are to our church. And let them know that they're more important than even the birds. And that you're going to take care of them and that they don't need to worry. And that goes for us adults, too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. sinner come heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal.
Choir, beautiful song. Ron, you always do such a great job with the children's part. And Mike, I owe you an apology. Every time I'm worship leader, he always reminds me, Randy, after you do the opening prayer, please introduce the children's time. And I always say to him, I'll give it my best shot. And if you see me halfway to my seat, I always remember halfway back to my seat, oh shoot, and Mike is already, let the children please come. Sorry, Mike, I'm very hopeless with that area. I'm usually pretty confident, but somehow I can't grasp that piece of it. I'm sorry. Oh, my. I'm just glad the Lord takes me as I am. And Laurel, too. All right, would you join me in reading God's Word, please? First, we'll be reading from Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 to 30. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Turn over to Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Lord, bless the reading of this word.
And now let's stand together and sing, Come Ye Sinners, Come Ye Sinners.
Just in case.
Wait,
what's that?
I said, in case it's windy.
just in case, stand, poor Jackie over there, somebody needs to just come over and just wrap you up. You're doing okay though. Also, for worship when we park out here, I don't know why I'm going right into the announcements. We typically park in the back. Now, if you've got a handicap or a disability that means you need to be up here close, that's fine. We may move your car for you after you get out or something, but we'll work those things out as the year goes on. We've got like four or five more of these coming up, so we'll perfect it over the next couple months. All right. So, if you were left to your own devices, not folks that have to get up because they have to go to work, but left to your own devices, how many of you here would consider yourselves early birds? Matthew said, don't say this to them. There's a lot of you, for those of you online, there's a lot of them early birds. You wake up in the morning and you're ready to go. How many of you would you consider yourselves night owls? Okay, well, it's still a pretty sizable proportion. It's not quite two-thirds to one-third. That's not bad. So, my buddy Bryson, sometimes I call him Doo-Doo Bear, but his name is Bryson. It's been his nickname for 20 years. I can't change it now. He and I are the opposite. I am a night owl, and he is an early bird. In fact, on days when I don't have to be up in the morning, there are nights where we call it the changing of the guards. I'll send him an Instagram reel that will be like a good morning to him because I'm about to go to bed as he's about to get up. He's like a 4 a.m. guy, right? And that's nuts, right? Like, who does that? He wakes up and goes and walks like 3 miles every morning, and then he does his devotions, and then he hits the Instagram so that he has something ready for me when I wake up. Last night as I was going to bed, I sent him a little reel of it. It was a snake eating itself. No. Right, sometimes I do horrible stuff to wake for him to wake up. Anyway, I said all that to say this. I think what we find there is a tension between the night owls and the early birds. Not quite as much as between Democrats and Republicans, but there is a tension that comes with these condescending lines that we say to each other. Because when we're on retreat, at about 8:30, I'll say to Bryson, well, it's about bedtime, isn't it? Getting all tuckered out. And he'll look at me and say, well, I was thinking it was just about bedtime. 30 minutes ago, I think I'll head to bed. I'm tired. But then he gets me back. And these early birds, they have their own little lines that they like to say, right? Like when you get up and you join them for breakfast, they're like, well, the day is almost over. It's 8 in the morning. What are you talking about? Well, I've already done nothing. That's the count. Nothing. They may say that. Or sometimes they'll, because they see you, because if you're not a morning person, you kind of drag for a little while, right? And they'll say something mean like, well, there's no rest for the weary. Which leads us to today's sermon. Whose line is it anyway? Where does the saying, there's no rest for the weary, come from? Well, it has its roots in the Bible, believe it or not. But it is a misquote. It's misremembered. Now, in England, they say it correctly. But in America, we say it wrong. You've heard that saying before, there's no rest for the weary, right? It's like somebody misheard it or misremembered it and said it once, and everybody heard it and started saying it the wrong way. The actual quote comes from the prophet Isaiah. The situation, those of you that join me on Wednesday mornings for our Bible study, we're working our way through Isaiah. And Isaiah is a lot of God saying to the people, you're doing it wrong. Get right with the Lord. Over and over again. Well, in this section, it's in the 50s, Isaiah, or the Lord, is saying about the people, they are wickedly covetous, which is a weird thing to be, right? Wickedly covetous. Covetous we typically mean is you want other people's stuff, but they've become wickedly covetous. And God got angry, and he always cracks me up when God says, and so I hid myself from them, which I know this isn't God, but it's the image I get is like God, like, hiding from them. But there's a reality to that. When you find yourself off and acting wicked, it is hard hard to connect with God. There's a disconnect that happens there. And this is all part of that chapter 57 of Isaiah. He says, they tried to find me. They would even try to get themselves right, but they couldn't last long. And so they'd end up just drifting away again and becoming wicked again. And so this is the quote. The wicked are like a tossing sea that cannot keep still, tossing up mud and mire. There is no peace for the wicked. We say there's no rest for the weary, but the real line, the root of that is there is no peace for the wicked. You see, when you're guilty, when you're wicked, you gotta hustle. Have you ever told a lie, and then you had to tell another lie, and another lie, and you had to keep checking up and clarifying and fixing? Because here's the thing about people and lies, when you lie to them, sometimes they go and verify them, right? Sometimes they follow up just to make sure that was the truth. Do you ever talk about somebody? We call it gossip. I mean, gossip is really a broad category. But do you ever say something about someone? Maybe it's your friend, maybe it's your enemy. Did you ever say something a little bit snide about them? And then a little bit later, you're like, oh, I'm not sure the person I said that to is 100% reliable, right? You're not sure they're going to keep it to themselves. And so then when you see the person you talked about, friend or foe, you're a little bit nicer to them. You kind of go overboard just to make sure we're still friends. You don't know anything about what I said, right? You've got to hustle when you've been doing wicked stuff. You've got to hustle. Any kind of wickedness, I think you've got to hustle. And we tend to think of ourselves as the heroes of the story, right? We tend to think we are not ever in the wrong. But there are times when you and I become wicked. We do, and typically it comes from our minds and our mouths. Our bodies may follow the process, but usually our mouths can get us into so much trouble. I remember in seventh grade, my mom, Susan Bennett, used to volunteer at Braddock Middle School in the library. Now, I never told Mom this, but I...
Not today.
All he does is use the church as his personal confession. I'm still working out issues from seventh grade. Of course, there's no rest for the wicked. I never told my mom this, but I was never comfortable with her being in the school at the same time that I was. I was not a particularly bad kid. I did not get in trouble much. But I had a mouth on me. And one day I was in the library. My mom wasn't there yet. And I was sitting at the table with my seventh grade friends, and I don't remember what it was I said. I'm sure I wouldn't tell you if I did. It was bad enough. And we're laughing. And I look around, and everybody at the table has gotten quiet and is looking over my left shoulder. Mr. Lawrence, the librarian, had heard everything I said. The full paragraph, had stopped to listen to it. Yeah, right? The librarian missed. And man, oh man, he didn't say anything, which was even more terrifying. He just shook his head and walked away. Just so happened that was the day Mom's coming to school. How do you think the rest of my day went? Into the evening hours, I didn't see her right away, and she didn't talk to me right away, and I was hustling. Hi, Mom. Hey, can I do this? I'll go clean up my room real good. I had a hustle. I don't think he did tell you. I think he kept it to himself. You never brought it up. Whatever, it was horrible, whatever it was. Okay, just to be clear, you all say horrible stuff too. It was like 20, 35 years ago. Leave me alone. Anyway, our mouths get us into trouble, and then we have to hustle, and there is no peace for the wicked. We become the weary wicked. We wear ourselves out hustling when we've been wicked. Isaiah says that the wicked are like being, it's like they're caught in the waves of the sea, and they're tumbling and tumbling to and fro. Have you ever, I had a brief stint of being a boogie boarder at Ocean City. I was never a surfer, but I had a brief stint of boogie boarding. And honestly, the sea can get kind of rough there. And a couple times I crashed bad enough that I was like, I'm not doing this anymore. But have you ever been under the sea, crashed and under, and the sea weighs more than you do. And it takes you and it rolls you around and sand gets up into your bathing suit and everything, right? It's in your mouth and you sputter your way to the shore. That's what it feels like when you're wicked. As I went to bed last night, I thought, oh, there are a whole bunch of stories. Because I had one story in mind, and then I was like, there's all these stories in the Bible where people did end up hustling because they were wicked. I might have done the story of Saul. You know, he was decent to begin with, but then he turned wicked. And he was getting headaches all the time. And he couldn't make up his mind. Does he hate David? Does he love David? He'd go back and forth, wanting to kill David and then wanting to love him as a son. He was all over the place. Because he was not at ease with himself. Saul, who became Paul, was equally bad. He thought he was being faithful. He was killing Christians and thinking he was doing the right thing. Even his ailment, when he becomes blind, is because he was blind. He couldn't see that he was doing the wrong thing. But one of my favorite stories of someone who is just clearly worn themselves out with wickedness is the story of Zacchaeus. I tell it a lot because it's such a great story. I love the story. Jesus was passing through the city of Jericho, and there was a man there named Zacchaeus. And he was a chief tax collector. Not just low level like Matthew was. This was the chief tax collector. And he was very rich. Now, I've said this enough times that you all know. Those tax collectors, I mean, none of us, I think, like paying taxes. Most of us spend a fair amount of time complaining about it, probably. We don't necessarily hate the individuals that work for the IRS, though, right? Like, but then the people that decide, right? This guy, the tax collectors, just by nature, were dishonest thieves. They would collect what they needed to for Rome, but then they would collect as much as they wanted for themselves, too. They were traitors to the nation. Wherever they were, but to the nation of Israel, they were despised by everyone. And they lived it. They typically were Jews. And so they were seen as traitors. And so they walked the streets and people would hate them. Can you imagine what it's like to walk the streets just to go to the market and they're like, spitting at you and stuff. And then you take note of them. So you can even raise their taxes more because they spit at you. It was a wicked, awful relationship that the Jews had with the tax collectors, and Zacchaeus was one of them. Now, he was a shorter fellow with a very big problem. He had worn himself out with this wickedness. Well, Jesus came to the city. We good?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Jesus came to the city of Jericho, and Zacchaeus had heard of Jesus, and he wanted to get a look. I don't think he had any real, he got up that day with no real expectations. But when he heard Jesus was coming, he thought, I got to see this fellow. I got to get a look at him. And so he went to the crowd that was pushing through and could see him because he's short. But he was smart. And as weary as he might have been because of his wickedness, he summoned the energy to run ahead. He could see where the path was that Jesus was leading. He ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree. Now, that's just, when was the last time you saw a grown man climb a tree in his work clothes? Like, you know, like a business suit, right? Because this is in his good clothes. He climbed up a tree, and he's looking, and he can see as Jesus, he's just hoping to catch a glimpse of Jesus. He's not hoping for anything, I don't think. He just wanted to see him. This man who brings salvation. This man who proclaims forgiveness to people. Because that did perk his interest. He proclaims forgiveness to people. This guy, just in the earlier chapter, his legs didn't work. He was paraplegic. And Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. Who can do that? Who has that kind of power? So he's climbed up in the tree. He's looking at this man who proclaims forgiveness. And he caught more than a glimpse of him, because Jesus caught a glimpse of Zacchaeus. Somehow he knew who Zacchaeus was. Was it the crowd who talked about him? Maybe. Right? I don't know that Jesus just knew everybody he encountered without knowing them. You know what I mean? Was it the crowd? Look at Zacchaeus up in the tree. Tax collector. Right? Like, whatever he said, Jesus was interested, because this man had climbed a tree to see him. And so he walks up to the tree, and he looks up at the tree, and he says, Zacchaeus, come down from there. I need to go to your house tonight for dinner. And Zacchaeus scrambled down the tree and was excited. And so he, as he jumped down, he said, okay, well, let's go. And off they go down a side street to Zacchaeus' house. And there they are, walking side by side. I imagine the conversation they had. I'm sure they talked, right? I don't know what kind of questions Jesus asks people, right? Like, when you're just, and I mean, this is a hated man. Everybody hates him. What did he say to him? Do you have any kids? I don't know. Like, I can't imagine what kind of small talk they had on the way. Well, the crowd was not happy. They were miserable at the idea that Jesus would spend his day in Jericho with a tax collector. Wow. And they began to grumble and complain, and it got louder and more angry as they walked. And I mean, Jesus and Zacchaeus can hear it. And I can imagine Jesus ignored what was being said as he continued to have a conversation, but Zacchaeus could hear it all. Do you ever be having a conversation with someone and you can't listen to this conversation because you can hear something over here that you really, really want to hear or need to hear? And so finally Zacchaeus stops. Just stop. Says, look. He looks at the crowd and says, look, half of my possessions I'll give to the poor. And if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I'll pay it back four times. What just happened? He's a chief tax collector. Is he going to quit his job? What just happened? And if you start doing the math, I don't know if you've ever run those numbers, but they don't make sense. No matter how wealthy you are, you take the first half and you've given it away to the poor. Okay. Now if you've cheated anyone, he's a tax collector. He's cheated everyone. How in the world did he pay this back? How in the world can he pay it back? I don't know. But what is going on in Zacchaeus' heart is real. He is having a real experience of something he didn't set out to do today. He has transformed. And Jesus says, I love this. He says, today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and save the lost. It's easy to forget he was Jewish. It's easy to forget he too was a son of Abraham. It's easy to forget he too went to Sunday school class, right? He too had a bar mitzvah at some point. And then something went wrong in his life. He made a bad choice that led to another bad choice that led to more things. And it just, the sea churned up all this mire and he was miserable. Did you ever get into something and you just don't know how to get out? There is no rest for the way. And what was it that triggered this change, right? And what, he didn't wake up thinking, I'm going to give my life to Christ and change my whole world. He didn't climb up that tree necessarily thinking, I'm ready to make a change. At some point, whether it was the climbing down or maybe the conversation between them, he decided to make a change in his life. There's no rest for the wicked. But you know, Jesus says the exact opposite. Randy just read it, right? It's beautiful. Come to me, all of you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, in all of my years of preaching, I've preached that passage enough times that I should know better, but I have always preached that, I think, of, in my mind, it's the people who are working hard and are tired, or are carrying a, Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me, right? Like, if you're carrying a cross, if you're doing good, doing the right thing, and sometimes there are burdens that weigh you down, and I think it preaches that way too. But when you've willingly entered into a situation where you're carrying a burden, because a lot of us are. A lot of us have things that we carry that do tire us out, but we're doing the right thing. There are a lot of, it takes a season or two before that burden lightens up. I think Jesus does resolve that, and the burden does get lighter, but for some of us, that burden can go on for quite some time. I don't know that this passage is really intended for those folks. I mean, you're faithful. That's good. You're doing the right thing. Keep up the good work. Jesus is there with you and all that. But sometimes you do get worn out and tired. This passage is not worded so much for those folks. This is for the people who are the weary wicked. Because when something is off in your soul, you just get worn out. And sometimes there's something amiss between you and God. And so you have a hard time resting, finding rest and peace. And not to accuse us all of being wicked, but we certainly go through times where just something just isn't quite right. And sometimes you know exactly what's causing it. And sometimes you ignore that and just say, well, I don't know what's wrong. Because you don't really want to change the behavior, change the attitude, or repair the relationship. There are all kinds of things that wear us out. And Jesus says, come to me with your weary, with your burdens. Those of you that are tired and worn out and weary, come to me with your burdens, and I'll give you rest. That's not so much about doing the right thing as when you're doing the wrong thing and you're carrying this burden. It's a burden of guilt, a burden of shame, a burden of regret. And Jesus has just come to me. I always used to love singing, take your burden to the Lord and leave her there. Leave her there. Leave her there. Well, that's how I sang it when I was in third grade. If you trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. There is a freedom, though, that comes to bringing your burden to God and leaving it there. And some of those burdens are hard to give up. Sometimes it's easier to hold on to the addiction or the guilt or the habit. A lot of us here probably didn't come here thinking, I'm going to leave my burden here today. But I'll bet there are a few of you here that have been carrying something for a while that you could leave here. That you could, during the final hymn, metaphorically speaking or for real, bring it up here and just leave it on the table and walk away free. There is a freedom to a clear conscience, a lightness. When you don't have anything to be guilty for or regretful about, when you just have already given to, he will forgive you. Like, it's what Isaiah is saying. If they would just return to me and stay returned, they would be free. They could find rest. You could sleep at night. You could stop grinding your teeth all the time. If you came here with a burden today, and it's something you need to leave here, I challenge you to take that up, this opportunity, and say, Lord, this has been going on for some time. And I need it to stop. I want it to stop. And I don't know how to make it better. And that's broad enough for all of us. There's probably a lot of us have something that is not sitting right. Leave it here today. And walk away from this pavilion free. Let's pray. Well, Lord, those that are carrying burdens today, Lord, we lift them up to you and pray that you will help them leave leave their burden here, that they might find rest in you. Because your yoke is easy, and your burden is light. Lord, help us all to have a clear conscience and a new life in forgiveness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Mike, for the message today. Now, as the ushers prepare to come, let's prepare to give a portion of resources back to the Lord.
Randy, I'm the same way. You can tell me something. Jackie could have whispered, "Don't forget to tell them," and I would have forgotten already. Like, I do it every time, too. I don't think I said this at the beginning. Micah pointed out that it is exactly to the day, 5 years ago today, we were out here. And it was windier than you're crying about the wind today. It was windy that day. And we broke ground for that building. Happy 5-year anniversary, folks. We did it. We did it. We do have several prayer concerns. We've had a run of losses in our church community. Prayers for Harriet Downing. And well, for the Leiter family, Harriet's funeral will be this evening at 5 p.m. At Osborne's. Is it 4 o'clock the viewing starts? 4 p.m. the viewing starts. Music start at 4:30, and then the funeral will be at 5. Also coming up next Friday, will be the viewing for Ronnie Baker, starting at 1 p.m. all the way to 7 p.m., and that will be here at the church, and the funeral will be Saturday at 2 p.m. for Ronnie Baker. Also, I didn't see the Castles here today. Prayers for Megan. Her brother-in-law has been, he's a young fella, and has been fighting cancer, and he may have died probably, maybe in the night. I don't know. It's any hour now, he will be gone. So prayers for the Castle family. Eric was apparently just a really full of life kind of guy, and just prayers for the family. Also, Dawn Morrison texted me this morning. She was admitted last night to the hospital. She has pneumonia. And those of you that know Dawn, she has been wrestling with this particular spate of troubles for about 3 weeks now. And that's wearing her out. That's quite a long time to be struggling with breathing issues, among other things. Graduate week is next Sunday. Grace is asking for volunteers to help with a beverage and cake setup. We'll have a cake for the kids out in the foyer. If you can help with just setting up the beverages and the cake, talk to Grace about that. You'll just need to be at the church by 9 a.m. instead of 10 for the setup. We also have a yard sale coming up. It is it's Memorial Day weekend. We always have a yard sale out here at the pavilion. Drop-off is Thursday. Pretty much any time, right, Mom? Like if they 8 to 5 is the official, if you would like to come out and help with that, it's a lot of work. I mean, you all give a lot of stuff to it, but there's a lot of organization and setup and pricing and all of that stuff goes on. Not all of it is heavy work. Some of it is lighter work. Yeah.
Setup is 1 to 5.
Drop off is 8 to 5. If you get here before they arrive, just set it in here. Right here. Anyway, it's a lot. I know a lot of you kind of look forward to the time you spend together. It's a lot of fun. And if you're new to the church, it's a great way to get to know some of the folks at the church. Because they stand around and talk and laugh and price it to sell. That yard sale is going to be Friday and Saturday from 8 to 2. If you want to donate to the bake sale, please see Kathy Myers. Kathy, where are you? Well, she will too. Anyway, see Kathy Myers if you want to donate to the bake sale. Prayer garden, we're going to have a prayer garden meeting right after church here. You may have noticed some work has been done in this little grove of trees between the road and the pavilion. That is going to become our new prayer garden. And Joan Canode and Dean Schultnick have volunteered to take on the role of gardeners, but they need help. They want help. And so they're going to have just a brief kind of organizational meeting in the garden afterward. They're going to show you their plans and talk about plans for the future. Anything you guys want to add to that? We're not talking about a long meeting. This is a quick meeting. Just to, if you want to be a part of it, head over there and just let them know you're here and maybe give them your name and your number. Eric Jones got something.
It's just it's a meet and greet, and hopefully you'll be interested to join us, and we'll have an organizational meeting at a different group when we get a group. And then we will have, our meetings will be in the dirt, in the garden.
Thank you, John. Meet and greet in the garden. No shovels today, but we'll need them in the future. Also, not long after that meeting ends, there will also be a kickoff luncheon for the One Day at a Time group that is starting. This is a new ministry we're creating, a new group we're forming for folks that are going through the grief process. And, you know, there's no end line to that sometimes. Sometimes our grief, when we lose someone that is beloved, it goes on for years. And so this is specifically designed for widows and widowers and folks that have gone through loss, and gives them a chance to get together. It is more of an action-oriented group, though. I mean, I think they plan to get out and do stuff. It's not sitting around necessarily talking about grief so much as, you know, going to dinner theaters and forming a basketball league or something. I don't think they're going to play basketball. But anyway, that's coming up. That's in the sanctuary. After church, you've got plenty of time to get down there. You've got time to make it to the meet and greet and still make it down there. Lisa said, don't. And if you didn't sign up for it, Lisa, as usual, made extra just in case. She assumed a few of you didn't sign up. You can still are encouraged encouraged to join and join them. All right, yeah, Graduate Sunday is next week. The last day to email graduate photos is today. So email them to the church office today. And Wednesday, we are going to have, looks like pizza. You're welcome to bring sides. We're going to, pizza will be the main dish. Weather permitting, we may gather at the campfire. I'll send an email and a remind text to let you know for sure. But we're hoping to be at the campfire, but let's play by ear. And let's see, as far as worship here goes, parking at, yeah, park, if you can park behind the, if you're welcome to park in the parking lot. I mean, whatever works. What we do try to do is keep this area, see how many folks are sitting back there. A lot of times folks like to just kind of spread out back there. And so we don't want to congest the place with cars unless we need to. If you've got mobility issues, we'll work that out. It's not an issue. However, if you can, park somewhere else. Bring your back blankets and your jackets, although by even next month, it's probably going to be, it'll be too hot for you then. You're right about that. All right. I think that's it. Yeah, Ricky?
Can you help us picking up the plastic chairs and putting them in the rack after service?
Thank you, Rick. Yep, we put these chairs away on the racks right after church. We'll take a few minutes. Yeah, Rick?
A few words about yesterday. It was a great day. We had the auto show. The cars were tremendous. A lot of you were here. I saw many of you here. That was great. A lot of the proceeds go to the Learning Center. Mike chose a car. It is the pastor's prize. It was a Chevy Impala, wasn't it?
It was. I hate to admit it. I'm a Ford guy. Yeah, Ray, it's not in my notes, and like I mentioned earlier, if it's not in the notes, I got this for forget. Yeah, it was a great event here yesterday. The car show put on by the Learning Center, and Art of Illusions is a car club, I think, and they do a lot of stuff, but they really put on a great show. They're already hoping to plan another one here for next year. They made these trophies out of pistons and car parts that were just, they were works of art. And yeah, there was a pastor's prize that had, it had a cross on it. It was very cool looking. And I chose, my favorite was a Chevy Impala, like a 62 Chevy Impala. That thing looked like, yeah, that thing looked good. So anyway, nothing angry. All right, I believe I've now come to the end of it. Look at this, right on time. Let's stand for the doxology.
Stay here today. Thank you for the message that you gave through Pastor Mike. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts that have been given, and may we use those to glorify your kingdom and to expand your kingdom, Father. And Lord, now as we pray, as you taught us to pray,
our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's go down in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.